almost define embedded in terms of what it isn't. It's not stuff that goes into a laptop or a desktop. It's also not supercomputers. So supercomputers are a particularly difficult thing to program. They're not traditional programming, but they're also not embedded. I think some of that is because they don't have constraints about heat dissipation, I/O, power size, or memory. But, yes?
I would add cost.
Cost, interestingly, cost is often, well, yes, and yes, I think that's an excellent point because it's often constrained by cost. Thank you. You passed this back. Yes.
Just to be contrary, because I like to be contrary. Cost is dependent upon your market, and if your market's commercial, then it's definitely cost. But if your market is something that is not cost sensitive,
right.
The other items are much more important.
And yeah, and so this is the list here is not intended to be applicable to every single embedded device. So cost is frequently a consideration. Actually, it's always a consideration. Frequently, is frequently a primary constraint, but not always. Taking, for example, your missile guidance system. Cost is a consideration, but it's not the primary consideration. Probably getting the warhead to the correct place is the primary consideration in the right amount of time. Yes?
I think another thing that often comes in is that you, if it's an embedded system, you have control over it. Like, users don't just install something there. You control the vehicle platform, basically.
I think that's an excellent point, and that's the kind of, that's one of the reasons I like embedded software. So if you're a control freak, embedded is a good place to be. I am a control freak. I do not like, if I finally get something to work, I don't want somebody going in there and messing with it. If you want to know what your environment is, embedded is typically a good place to be, which raises what is, to me, an interesting question. I know that phones, about 10 years ago, phones were an embedded device. And I think right now, they're not really embedded devices anymore. But I'm open to lots of people, you know, because it's, what we're seeing is that it's kind of blurry. What the heck is this? And with a lot of computing, people are always scratching around at the boundaries. So where do you set a boundary? That's always an excellent question. And you know, these are just names. Doesn't really make that much difference whether you call something embedded or not. It's the techniques that you use. So that's the kind of thing that I work on. I haven't specifically worked on that. It is a piece of manufacturing equipment. And it does laser cutting. So, specifically, what that particular device does is it, so that orange stuff, that's called a flex circuit. So, circuit boards, we're all software folks here. Anybody mess with hardware? Yeah, okay, so you all know what circuit boards are. Anybody in here not know what a circuit board is? No one who's willing to raise their hand. That's okay. So circuit boards are those things that the ICs get soldered onto so that they all work together. It makes the electrical connections. Flex circuits are those same things, except you can bend them. They have the advantage that if you do your circuit board as a flex circuit, and it's not too big, you don't need wires, because you can fold it up into whatever shape you need it to be. There are limits. They don't, you know, they don't twist the way wires do to a large extent. So the product that I work on drills vias in flex circuits. A via is a hole. Thanks. So these flex circuits, they have alternating layers of insulator and patterns of conductors. And you want to be able to connect different places on integrated circuits together with other places. So you run them through these conductors that are in the flex circuit. And in order to get different layers connected together or to get one IC connected to a particular place, you cut holes partway through, sometimes all the way through, but sometimes just part of the way through the flex circuit, which turns out to be kind of tricky. It's hard to do with a mechanical drill. It's possible. But lasers turn out to do not too bad a job at this. And so what you see here is a picture of a blind via in a flex circuit cut by a laser. And you would think, well, all right, I'm just going to aim this. I've got this laser. It's got such a so big a beam. I'm just going to aim that at that flex circuit and go bah, and it's going to just clean right up. And it's not quite that simple. There are patterns that are traced out in order to cut that circle. And it might be a spiral. It might be a circle. There's a pattern that my company uses called a trepan, which is a circle with a divot cut out of the middle. And then there are different, so there you want to cut that circle initially, and then you want to clean it out at the bottom, because you want as much conductive surface at the bottom as you can. So there are different ways of using the laser in order to cut that stuff away and then clean it out. So it looks like it ought to be simple, and probably it ought to be simple. We don't make it simple. So the hardware that's involved with that is, first of all, our laser. And then there's oftentimes an XY linear stage. So that's two linear motors, one running in the X direction, one running in the Y direction, that can shuttle this circuit around underneath the laser. Making sense? Okay. Then what does most of the work with the laser is this mirror galvanometer. And we get a pair of them. That's only one. That is not an XY galvanometer. That is only an X galvanometer or a Y galvanometer. So I'm an old duffer, and I took physics in high school in the 70s. And back then, when I took physics, they had these ammeters. They had needles. Anybody remember those? Okay, some of a bunch of you. So you young folks, you won't know what this is. So is there anyone who hasn't ever played with ammeters with a needle? Okay, no one who's willing to admit. So the mechanism inside the mirror galvanometer is exactly the same as the meter. As you run more current in there, the meter deflects. So instead of hanging the mirror off of the needle, you center the mirror on the post, and as you run more current in, the mirror rotates. And you can get very high rates of angular change of the mirror in order to aim that laser at different places. So you put one in place, and then you have it going back and forth. You put another in place, and you have it going back and forth. And you can aim the laser at lots of different places using two of these guys. They're not quite linear because they're working angularly. So there's some interesting, come up at the front.
Non-linear.
Yeah, it's close to linear, and for small angles you can approximate it linearly. And so to a large extent, we try not to have large deflections in the mirror. But you still have to have some kind of a calibration to turn it into linear data. I'm not going to go into the calibration. So the last part of it is something that has just been relatively recently added. This is an acousto-optic deflect well. This is not one. This is a picture of how one might think about an acousto-optic deflector, which is faster than a galvanometer. So this is a crystal that has a high-frequency sound running into it. So there's an acoustic coupler to the crystal running in the, I believe, megahertz range. I'm a software guy. This was all handled by the hardware clips. And so what you do is you run different frequencies in there, and what that sets up is an interference pattern inside the crystal. So as you change the frequency, you can change the diffraction grating in effect that's present in the crystal. This has a very fast rate of change. So we can change things above the megahertz range. But we can't deflect the beam very much with this. So at the end of the story, what we're going to have is an XY linear stage that's moving things very slowly because it's got a lot of mass. We've got a mirror galvanometer, which used to be about as fast as we could move a laser beam. And then, so that's the XY linear stage is moving at the bottom. The mirror galvanometer is taking a laser. And then the acousto-optic deflector is providing little tiny adjustments on what the galvanometer is doing to the laser beam. I haven't lost anybody yet. Nobody's asleep yet. The compute platform that I'm working with. So there's a Windows computer. I didn't pick it. it's a habit of the companies. And then the underlying embedded stuff is the stuff below the Windows computer. And let me add that when I came in to work for this company about a little over 3 years ago, all of this stuff was in place. So there was functioning software, there was a Windows computer hooked up to exactly this hardware embedded system. And then almost, well, I would say 98% of this stuff we're going to talk about is software that changed over 3 years in order to get stuff to run faster. That's really the goal. How do you get stuff to run faster? So we've got a microcontroller. How many folks have seen, what's the name of the movie? Well, anyway, the character was the shoveler. Maybe someone can tell me what the name of the movie was?
Mystery Men.
Mystery Men, thank you. How many of you have seen Mystery Men? Yes. Yeah, okay. So anyway, there was this character called the shoveler, and he was really good with a shovel. Okay. So the microcontroller is the shoveler. He's a superhero. The microcontroller is the shoveler. So it takes a whole pile of data in one shot from the Windows computer. Actually, it's shared memory. And then the microcontroller has the job of shoveling the data into these two DSPs at about the time when they need it. So the DSPs don't have to handle big bulks of data. They just kind of, they've got some buffer, but they don't have a huge buffer. The microcontroller has the big buffer. That was actually a hack that was introduced before I got there. The original design did not include the microcontroller. They found they had bandwidth issues getting the data in. So they added that.
When you say big buffer, what are we listening
to? Nah, yeah, okay, right, thank you. Yeah, so it's big to me. It's 32 meg. Yeah, so it's tiny. It's big to me. I'm an embedded guy. I tend to think in small amounts of memory. But yeah, for someone who's working on the Windows platform, it's like they have to keep shutting stuff down there all the time. They're always producing stuff. Thank you. Oh, yeah, you deserve this. But we'll have to pass this down.
I think we should start to cut myself with a good injury.
Oh, yeah, actually, we've done that.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Fortunately, these are soft. So, yeah, I smacked somebody in the head with a pack of skills.
Hilarity ensued.
So we've got two DSPs, and then we've got an FPGA that I don't program. The hardware guys take care of it. Do you know, everybody know what an FPGA is? Okay, good. Thank you for holding up your hands. An FPGA is short for Field Programmable Gate Array, and it's a bunch of hardware, you know, gates and flip-flops and memories and stuff like that, all in one package that you can configure with software. So they end up writing their stuff in a different programming language, Verilog or VHDL, I've never learned either of them. From what I hear, they're much worse than C++. You're better off where you are. Okay, so we've got two DSPs. One of them is running slower than the other. The controls guys that I work with, controls guys are folks who know how to make things move. The controls guys that I work with tend to think about these DSPs in terms of frequencies. So where it says 50 microseconds, they would call that a 20 kilohertz DSP, and this is a 200 kilohertz DSP. But I tend to think about them in terms of time, because I have to get done in a certain amount of time. And that time is exactly what you see right there. So I'm counting clocks. And any of you folks who do real time out there, is there anyone who doesn't count clocks if you do real time development? Okay, so I'm not alone in this. The compute platforms. So we've got our Windows control computer. That's almost everything's been being written in C# and .NET, and it is extraordinarily non-real time. As the whole idea of garbage collection just bothers me. There are people who like it, you know, and they're welcome to it. But yeah, anything that just decides, all right, it's time for me to garbage collect and walks away so it can take care of its own business and then comes back, that just bothers me. So we've got our microcontroller, that's an analog device's Blackfin, and I was hoping to talk about that as little as possible, but I don't get to avoid that. And then to me, the interesting part is these tiger-shark DSPs. So that's where our real-time stuff is really happening. In 2006, they were pretty good hardware, and that's when these circuit boards were designed. Hardware is expensive to develop, and once you have a hardware platform, there tends to be a lot of software, investment in that platform. So it becomes difficult to move away from that platform once it exists. So these were really good in 2006. We're still using them. They're no longer, I mean, 600 megahertz used to be a very respectable clock rate. It's still not too bad. So we're doing what we need to do. We can accomplish it with this. But this is no longer state of the art. So it's a 600 megahertz static superscalar. Anybody not know what superscalar means? Okay, so we're talking about something that can execute multiple instructions inside of one clock cycle. So the Intel chips, the AMD chips that you use these days, these are all superscalar, but they hide it. So when you're writing software, you don't have to know that it's actually a superscalar machine running underneath. I don't actually have to know, but I like to know. The static superscalar aspect of this is particularly interesting to me because the typical superscalar processors are doing their scheduling in their hardware. So as their instructions are coming up, they're looking at them saying, well, can I do this one at the same time as this other one? Can I do get this one done ahead? With the static superscalar, they're letting their compiler do that. So the compiler looks at the set of instructions. And it says, well, can I do this one or this one or this one right now? And what that allows me to do is look at the disassembly. After the compiler runs, I can say, how efficient is my algorithm? So if it's not static, like the Intel chips and the AMD chips, then I have to work a little bit harder to find out how well is this going to run. So the Harvard architecture means that it can fetch both instructions and data at the same time. 3 megabytes of internal memory. For embedded development, this is wallowing in memory. When I first heard I was going to be working on tiger sharks when I started at this company, I said, there'll be room to breathe. Okay. And it really is wallowing in memory from an embedded aspect. What I will say is that no matter how much memory you have, you can burn through it in an instant. So whatever memory you have, you should cherish it, no matter what environment you're working in. So we build the same code for two different targets. We have a C++ or a Windows simulation that runs without any hardware. And all of the software builds for that. And we can run that in the Visual Studio debugger. We have the Visual DSP compiler that runs over the same code base and produces code for the embedded system. Really, the thing that amazes me the most with the Visual DSP code is just how compliant it is with C++, 98, and 03. And I think that is, to a large extent, due to they use the Edison Design Group front end for the C++ compiler, which, you know, it does templates, it does, you would expect for a relatively small company to have lots of problems. They have had a few, I've experienced a few problems with the compiler that tends to be at the back end. The front end is really good. And I've been using a cycle accurate processor simulation, so I can, something, when I'm trying to find out how something really executes, I can do that. Okay. So the simulation, like I said, the simulation runs entirely under Windows. I'm just going to fix this up so I can see where I'm going. So about 95% of the code compiles for both environments. There's about 5% of the code that's glue, that particularly the communication from the microcontroller to the DSP to the FPGA. Funny thing about when you're running in a simulation, when you read back a register, you don't get the right value. So nobody laughed.
It's fine.
Okay, thank you. So at least some of you got that. So there's some stuff in order to make the simulation fairly accurate. The nice thing about our simulation is that we're not highly dependent on feedback. We're mostly trying to see whether the stuff we're throwing at the mirrors and the laser and, you know, the stages and all that stuff, if we're sending the right stuff down. So that makes the simulation easier to use. If you were simulating something where most of the data was coming in, then it would be a lot more work. Okay, so I only have one place where I have real-time code. That's on the entire chart. So I'm not worrying about, I'm not trying to compile for two different platforms where both of them have to meet time constraints. And that could happen to somebody who's doing real-time development. I'm glad it doesn't happen to me. So I think that building for two or more compilers, probably a bunch of you do cross-platform development, right? Anybody who deals with, who writes code for Boost has this problem in spades. So I only have two, which is nice. It makes my job a little easier. But it is nice also to have two different compilers looking at my code, because that just makes for more robust code. But I do, on this idea of having the Windows simulation, I have an observation that when you have good tools in one environment, you tend to write code that works well in that environment. And you can get into real trouble when the code fails in the other environment. This doesn't happen a lot, but it does happen. And then all of a sudden, you know, being able to set a breakpoint. Ah, okay, let's talk about real time for just a second. Think about this problem. If you want to set a breakpoint in some code, and it's real time code, depending on your delivery schedule, if you have stuff that needs to be delivered every 2 minutes, it might be okay to set a breakpoint. But if you have stuff that has to be delivered in less than a second, then you'd have to be pretty tricky about setting a breakpoint, getting some information out, and then getting away from that breakpoint. So the faster the real-time system runs, if you're trying to actually see that system work, the less useful breakpoints become. Breakpoints are, for me, a big debug tool. They're really important. they don't work so well in real-time situations. So you have to come up with other tools. And there may be folks who sell tools for real-time developers who can solve this problem. I don't know who they are, so for the most part, my group and I have invented some tools. So for us, some ways in which our code is less than real C++, we have no exceptions. Exceptions are turned off in our compiler. So that means that if somebody puts a throw in the source code, it won't compile, which is a good thing. That's the time I want to be told I can't throw an exception if I can't throw an exception. There's no operating system, and let me put that sort of with scare quotes, because it's almost true, it's not quite true. We have relatively limited memory, although the embedded developers in the audience are scoffing at me right now. Because this is you don't have 3 megabytes in your wristwatch. So, and like I was saying earlier, there are no breakpoints and really no debugger. There are tools that embedded folks sell called in-circuit emulators, or ICE, where you can set a breakpoint and an embedded target. But as I was saying, for real-time development, that tends not to be very useful. So any time that we've really needed something like that, it hasn't done us any good. So I tend not to use them. Everybody still with me? Yeah? Okay. So when I got there, the build system already had no exceptions, and I really appreciate that they made that choice. In my opinion, some of their choices were wise, some were not. I think this was a really good choice. The main reason for that I think that's good, is that in terms of execution time, compiler vendors tend not to focus on how fast can I execute an exception. So if I've got real-time code, the thing I live with is predictability. It's more important for me that a piece of code take the same amount of time, or about the same amount of time, to execute every single freaking time than it is for it to be faster 95% of the time and really dog slow 5% of the time. An algorithm like that will kill me. So I'm always looking for very reliable execution times. And exceptions don't provide that for me. So there are no exceptions. I appreciate that I don't have to deal with the extra code that's added for the exceptions or the tables. And like I said, the handling of exceptions is slow. Yes, Dave.
I just wanted to mention that even for people that aren't doing hard real time, people that are doing parallel algorithms and that care about performance, unpredictability in terms of how long something's going to take to execute is a killer. And the only difference is, of course, that you know, in those other applications, they can afford an occasional, you know, in case of an emergency, you know, unpredictability. But you can't, because you need to meet hardware requirements. So it's really important to keep in mind, though, if you're thinking about efficiency, is predictable timing is important, because otherwise you can't schedule what things run against each other.
Oh, okay, thanks. Did everybody hear that? Yes?
Yes.
And just to elaborate on the last one, this is, so Herb Sutter's book, Exceptional C++, item 18, this was an example he had, and I cut straight to the punchline. His question was, how many execution paths are there in this piece of code? I took the liberty of copying his code almost verbatim. I had to reformat it a little bit. Writing code in PowerPoint slides is miserable. So it takes some reformatting.
But I keep wanting to capitalize all my lines.
So if you actually take code from Visual Studio and just copy and paste it to PowerPoint, it keeps the source formatting, it color codes it, and syntax highlights it.
Okay, well, that's it. I'll remember that for my next PowerPoint slide. Thank you. Yeah, and I should rely on Microsoft to provide something like that. So, but Herb's point with this piece of code was that if you're not thinking about exceptions, you know, I see about 3 execution paths through there. But as soon as you have the possibility of exceptions, you have 23 different ways of executing and returning from that function. And you're trying to say something, Dan.
Yeah, well, I'm sorry. So I understand your reasons for not using exceptions, and I think, you know, in your domain, totally appropriate. But this whole schema of looking at how many execution paths there are in code to see whether it's understandable what it does in case of an exception is just a wrong-headed approach. You will never get a grip on it by looking at execution paths. Mm-hmm. And it's just not a powerful way to look at it. So, but there are very simple, powerful ways to look at it, and if you want to know what those are, you should go to John Kell's talk, because he's going to be talking about exactly that.
Yeah, and I don't mean to emphasize the number of ways you can think about this execution path, but more that the number of instructions I'm going to execute varies wildly depending on whether an exception is thrown. So, thank you.
But that is really mostly due to the runtime cost of the exception handling, and not because of, you know, it's going to execute this thing in a different place.
Okay.
Because it's like it's a factor of 100 or something on most compilers.
Okay. Okay. So, and Dave's point is that I shouldn't worry about this. I should just worry about whether an exception gets thrown.
So. Pretty much. I mean, that will swamp all of these.
Yeah. Yeah. I completely agree with that. So I really like working without an operating system, and there are folks who when you work with computers, you have to have an operating system. Well, as a matter of fact, that's not the case, and it really comes down to somebody else was pointing out that if you're writing embedded code, you have control, and I am control freak. And I don't want anybody else getting in the way of me scheduling something. So I want to do it myself. As my son said when he was 2, my do it. So for me, I don't need to do file I/O. I've got no files. I've got no hard drives. The heap management is done by the C++ runtime. I didn't have to figure that out. The compiler vendor provides that to me. The scheduler, the lack of a scheduler, is something that I appreciate, because a scheduler, first of all, it takes time to schedule stuff. Secondly, they have their own algorithm for handling when things are scheduled and when they're not. I may not like their algorithm. I want to be. One minor downside is that there is no built-in, because I don't have an operating system, I have to figure out how to do the inter-thread communications. So I have to, or my team, the folks on my team, we have to build that. So we have to think about threads a little bit harder than if we had an operating system doing that work for us.
But you do have threads without the idioms.
So the question was, the statement was, you do have threads without an OS. And the short answer is sort of. We don't have threads in the traditional sense, but we do have interrupts. And an interrupt is a separate thread of execution. So it's not a thread in the traditional sense, but it's very much a thread of execution. So we have to think about them the same way everyone else in the room would think about threats. Yes, Dave?
Does this require a complete change of worldview if you start getting multi-core embedded processors?
Yes. Yeah. And so if I don't run out of time, I'll talk a little bit toward the end about how we handle the enterprise communication. And it is very much dependent on the environment you're working in. So, yeah, and I'm actually going slower than I thought I was going to go. I want to get to the code. So let me see if I can speed this up a little bit. So within the DSPs, we've got each DSP has a non-interrupt thread, sort of the background. We call that the communication thread. And it's responsible for getting stuff, non-time critical stuff, eventually up to the Windows computer. And for the Windows computer, actually the microcontroller, to get stuff down in. DSP 0 has a 50 microsecond servo interrupt. That's for handling real-time commands. And it also runs the servo code. Servo makes sense to anybody? It's the code that makes the hardware go. I don't know why they're called servos. The controls guys came up with that. But I just, you know, if that's what they call it, that's good with me. So on the 5 microsecond DSP, so we've got one running relatively slowly, one running relatively quickly. That's where the servo code for the galvanometers goes. And one of the things that I found out is that 5 microseconds is not very much time. Depending on, you know, as you have faster processors, and they've stopped accelerating quite the pace that they used to, you can think of how many processor clocks there are inside of a time interval. For me, because I have a 600 megahertz clock, that gives me 3,000 clocks, execution clocks, between interrupts. Now, I can't take all 3,000 of those to execute the code that I care about, because when the interrupt occurs, I have to save the processor state in the stack. Then I do the code that I care about. I'm going to read some sensors. I have to handle position commands that have come in. The sensors tell me how far off I am, so I have to adjust things. I'm not quite where I want to be. I want to aim a little bit over here. The position command says, well, you may have wanted to be back there back then, but now you want to be over here. There are several filters because the controls have a lot of filters. Then we have to write to the registers to say, okay, hardware, you're heading over here. Put this much current over here. Then, once we've got all that stuff done, we have to restore the processor state so we can return to the non-interrupt thread, and then do a little bit of background processing, and then the interrupt occurs again. So that gives us about 4.2 microseconds of actual processing time. That's if we're really pushing it, so I try to keep it below 4.2. Last time I counted, that's like, it was 2,600. I had something on my whiteboard.
Not awful.
Yeah, it's still achievable. I think we're about finally to get to the real code. When I walked in, they didn't identify four poles for me. I kind of learned these by watching the culture. So, one was that the embedded software has to handle more hardware. When I got there, it was pretty much just running the galvanometers. The stages were being run by the Windows computer. They had separate servos for that. Then we started to suck the XY stages into the embedded system so that there could be better coordination between the galvanometers and the stages. And then, more recently, we've been adding the acousto-optic deflectors. So the software needs to handle more hardware in the same amount of time. So like I said, we're increasing the coordination between the different pieces. So that means that you can't just run the galvanometer and only think about the galvanometer. You can't just run the stage. If you're running the stage, you have to say, well, what's the stage error? If the stage is off by a little bit, maybe I can make the galvanometer adjust for that. So these guys are starting to cross couple as the coordination increases. The feature resolution, increased. When I first got there, the feature resolution was about 5 microseconds, so every cycle I needed to get the galvanometer to a particular place. With the addition of the acousto-optic deflectors, we have 1 microsecond resolution about where is the beam supposed to be placed right now. So that's 5 times the throughput, going from 5 microseconds to 1 microsecond. And they also, it turns out, they wanted increased reliability, which is not necessarily, it's a good thing. I'm glad they have that goal. And then the last one, I just from observing management, this one's become really clear that we're not messing with the hardware. You guys compute with what you got. So my first observation for someone who wants to optimize something for speed is you should start with something that's not optimized for speed, and then you can feel really good about what you've done. So, and that sounds snide, and it is a little, but it turns out that, I'm not kidding. The folks who did the original design, who were not there when I got there, had some really amazing goals. So they wanted their servo control loop to be generated from MATLAB, because the controls guys love MATLAB. When I got there, they were under the realization, just kind of getting there, they'd started from this generated code. But they'd given up with the generation, and now they were hacking at the generated code. which is, and unfortunately, that's still the position we're in, because the 5 microsecond servo loop, we've been evolving it over time, but a bunch of the underlying infrastructure was designed around this generated code. And you know, as someone who's not doing greenfield development, you live with what you have, and you adjust the highest priorities. There are some things that are left over from this that we're still living with. So these were really important goals for the people who designed the system originally. But they ended up being goals that made it difficult for things to run fast. So 2 of these things didn't last very long. The MATLAB generated servo code, I never saw that happening. By the time I got there, they'd given up on it. But it still had ramifications in the code base. The commands streamed in XML, that was the first to go. That's particularly painful to think about, because the Tiger Sharp processor does not have a native 8-character byte. Its native data size is 32 bits for everything. And so for those of you who think about, you know, character streams or whatever, the Tiger Sharp compiler takes care of that synthetically by picking up a 32-bit value, doing shifts, masks, and rotates to determine what a character is, and then putting it back. It's amazing that the compiler can do it. But
you have an XML version for this?
Yeah, it's right. So anyway, the command streamed in XML. That was the first thing to go. That's not there anymore. But there's residue, because what they did was they took that XML and they said, well, okay, we can't do text processing, but we're going to retain the stream. So, and I'll talk about streaming a little bit more. We've now excised some of the streaming. The automatic recordability of computed values, that's still in there, and that ends up actually having a low cost. So it's still there, and it's extremely valuable. So I swiped this particular slide from Scott Myers, who swiped it from a fellow named Khan. And I don't actually want to go into the slide to a great extent, but the point of it is that there are a lot of different things you can optimize for. And some of those things are at odds with other things that you could optimize for. So when you design a system or when you're working on a system, you want to think about what's important to you. So, and that's partly the point to acknowledge that the original designers of the system had their values, and they just didn't happen to have performance as their highest value at the time. And maybe that was because they weren't pushing it as hard as we've now needed to push that platform. Getting close to the code, honest. So one of the things, when I got there, there wasn't a good way to know how close we were to the limit on the servo. Are we running hot? Have we got lots of space? There was a piece of the FPGA that would check to see if we violated the servo interrupt. But we didn't know how close we were until we'd actually blown it. So we needed to find some way of monitoring the servo. And one of the things we found was that we could only get a command into the embedded system, a real-time command into the embedded system every 200 microseconds. And one of the system design guys that I was working with said, we could do that 13 years ago. Why are you guys so slow? And I had to look at him and say, I don't know, I didn't design it. But we had to solve this problem. This was nobody knew why it was taking that. So what you have to do is you have to make tools, you have to measure stuff. The time's not the only thing you have to measure. And I'm walking into the first little fragment of code, finally. Lazy collaborations are a really useful thing. So there was an existing code called existing object called a profile that was used for measuring time. And it used a form of lazy evaluation where it would snag a time from a real-time clock, and then it would snag another one and do a difference. And then on another thread, you could say, well, what was that time? So we've extended that idea to basically, you've got a base class where you want to have a gauge that can stream itself. You want to be able to reset the gauge. So let's say I want to count how many times an event occurred since the last time I checked. So I make an integer, and on the servo loop, I can increment the integer. That's very fast. And then not on the servo loop, I can ask that same object, please stream yourself. In which case, it snags the value of that integer so that it can be modifying while the servo loop is still running. So it snags the current time that or value of that integer, and then later streams that out. The existing infrastructure, that data would have been is streamed as text. Text is not my favorite form, but it's what I live with. So the idea is to, on the servo loop, do something very fast. And then using that same object, do something that's going to take a long time, do that on a different thread where you don't care how long it's going to take. And then the other thing health gauges do is every time they instantiate themselves, they add themselves to a length list. Did that make sense? Is that at all interesting to anybody? Okay. So what I like about this is that when I'm doing time-sensitive code, I can put monitors in place, and I leave these in place. These are watching the servo loop every time the servo executes. They take very little time. They take some time. It's not free. But I can leave them in place, and I can always go to my health gauges and say, since the last time I checked, what's the worst case execution time for my servo? What's been the average execution time for my servo? If I have servo violations, what place did I interrupt? Because I got to interrupt someone. So just to reiterate what I went through before. Now, a lot of folks think that doing embedded development in C++, and I guess there are a bunch of folks doing embedded development in C++ in this room, so good for you. There are a bunch of folks who think that C is the only language. And by the time I was done with the health gauges, the thing that was nice about them is that they had some what is maybe not tricky code to Boost developers, but was kind of tricky code to me. Some fairly tricky code encapsulated in something that was really easy for a non-C++ guy to use. So it was sort of the rudiments of libraries. I could say, I want to use an integer health gauge. I'm going to drop it here. It had constructor requirements that gave it exactly what it needed. And it just worked once it was in place. And I think that's very difficult to do in C. So there's judicious use of virtual. So we're only using virtual calls on the non-interrupt threads. We have low overhead on the interrupting code. And most of the processing is postponed for the non-interrupt thread. So we use those for performance reports. We also use them for debugging. So we have some that we just always leave in place. And then if there's stuff that we need to monitor, we can drop these in place. And then just the results. So with these tools, you can now make measurements. Why do I only get a command into the embedded system every 200 microseconds? And I knew, when somebody asked me what that question was, I knew what the answer was. Because there was a piece of code that really annoyed the bejesus out of me, and I wanted it to go away. That had to be the source of the problem. And I was wrong.
You're still there?
The code's still there.
Wow.
No, actually, I got rid of it anyway. I got rid of it later.
Yeah, I mean, that's a real drag, you know, really, code bothering you is a real drag on development eventually anyway.
Yeah,
so.
So I had other excuses for getting rid of that. But it wasn't, this particular time, it wasn't the right excuse. So the culprit ended up being this microcontroller that I very much didn't want to be thinking about. Because it wasn't running any of this real-time code that I thought was really interesting. It was just the shoveler. So it turned out that it took 280 microseconds to get a message from the microcontroller into DSP0. Which is more than 200 microseconds. And we were getting a message in every 200 microseconds. Now, how did that happen? It turned out that each message from the microcontroller carried about 1.5 messages for DSP0. And DSP0 had the responsibility of reformatting the information when it got it, so it could turn this 1.5 messages into a message and save the other half for when the other half came the next time. The microcontroller was supposed to be so simple. It was just the shoveler. How could it be slow? But it had a microkernel scheduler, which is why earlier I said almost no operating system. So there was a scheduler. It had three threads, one of which was listening to the Windows system, one of which was just being itself in the middle of the world, and the other thread was responsible for pushing the data down to DSP0. It had code running in external memory. And the point about code running in external memory, I want to bring this up for the folks who are not doing embedded development. Where you keep your stuff, which memory your stuff is in, matters to all of us. Doesn't matter whether you're doing embedded development or desktop development or supercomputer development. There is stuff that is harder to get to. For all, I guess there are embedded systems where it doesn't matter because all of the code is in a very small space. But generally, where your stuff is matters.
types.
That is an awesome paper, by the way. Get a colored laser printer or send it to Kinko's or something, because the graphs in there are so much better if you get it in color.
Okay.
It's worth everybody printing out and reading.
Yeah, so this is an awesome paper. Dave's point, Dave's smarter than I am.
Louder.
This paper, I did not read it in depth. I don't know how many pages it is, but it's probably close to 100 pages. I read it in depth for the first 30 pages and then started skimming. But it is really interesting, and everyone who writes programs ought to think about how their memory, where their memory is coming from. Caches he cares about caches. For me, I cared about whether the data was in external memory or internal memory in the microcontroller. So, simply by, okay, I've gotten ahead of myself. Simply by moving data from the external memory into the internal memory in the black bin, I was able to remove 100 microseconds from that delivery time. So, where your code executes makes a difference. So there were no code changes in there. That was link changes only. Where does this code live? Took the microkernel, and this was an evolutionary thing because I was afraid of the code. First thing I did was I took those three threads and kind of glued them together, left the kernel in place, and turned that into a single polling loop. So the two of the threads were effectively dead. Then later on, I killed off the two threads, and finally, I yanked the kernel out. So that what's running in that microcontroller right now is just a polling loop. So we turned the three threads into a single polling loop, and with that, the delivery times dropped from 150 microseconds to 20 microseconds. If you remove the microkernel, that takes up space. So now all of the code fits in internal memory, and the delivery time drops to 5 microseconds. No code changes. That's not true. Okay, so changing from thread-based code to the polling loop removed a bunch of code, big code changes. But it's way simpler. Because somebody in here has to have the opinion that it's easier to think about multi-threaded code than single-threaded.
What?
There you are. Thank you. Somebody has to have that opinion. It's not my opinion. So if you can make your code single-threaded, it will probably have fewer errors.
That's the man with two brains.
That was too upset.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I'll grant you. So. We've got our delivery time down from 280 microseconds to 105 microseconds, and we have much less code. We have simpler code, we have no threads. And even though we've got this delivery time down under 5 microseconds, our minimum command time is still at 75 microseconds, which is better than 200. But it's not where we finally want to end up. So there's collateral damage. Anytime something runs faster, there will be other things that go wrong. So in this particular case, we exposed a timing window in the communication throttling between DSP0 and the microcontroller. We fixed that with some FPGA code. That didn't require a hardware change in the sense, it required one of my friends who knows VHDL or Verilog to go in and change some of their code. So we didn't add any green wires. So we're adding these acousto-optic deflectors. And up till now, we've been able to execute one command every 200 microseconds. We now have a request for executing the systems guys think about how fast is the beam moving. So the request was, I'm moving my beam at 3 meters per second. I want to have a feature, which is, say, a straight line or an arc, that I'm going to execute in 20 microseconds. So that gives me a 7-microsecond command. So the question was, how can we execute several real-time commands inside of 50 microseconds? And with the existing code, we had big initial compute spikes. So a command would come in, and it would say, oh my god, there's a command. And it would be off to the races. Well, we got to compute this. Don't forget that. Remember this other thing. And so we had to find a way to simplify it. We could not afford spikes of that size if we had to have two of them. The command format was streamed, and I talked about streaming a little while ago. So it took 4 microseconds to unstream. So to me, what I mean by streaming is that the data had to be read sequentially. So you'd pick up a piece of information, and it would say, well, you know, the next thing is going to be an integer, and it's going to be an integer for this line. All right, well, this next piece, that's going to be a float. And this next piece, and so you have to walk through each piece. You don't know what the size of a piece is until you've picked it up. And it took 4 microseconds to dig all that stuff out, and that was all being done on the interrupt. So I looked at that, and I talked to the system designer, and you know, I was talking about this 3 meters per second, 20 microsecond, or 3 meters per second, 20 micron feature, and that ended up being the design thrust. What we had right now. We needed to come up with a system that would do that. And for me, that was critical in terms of the development, was finding a specific goal, not 20 goals, not, you know, well, we need 24 things that are better. It's hard to think about too many things at once. So we picked a worst case. And we worked pretty hard at figuring out what that worst case would be. And I also squeezed him, and I said, you're not going to ask for it to go faster, are you? He said, oh, no, I wouldn't do that, which was not true, of course. But it gave me a target I could head for. So we all figured out what a target needed to be. We got agreement from the developers, from the folks who are going to make that requirement of the system. And we didn't lose focus. So in order to get the kinds of speeds that we needed, we had to simplify the algorithms. The command compute spike had to completely go away. So we changed algorithms significantly. There was data that was being recomputed that the control computer knew, but wasn't being passed down because it was going to be recomputed at the other end. I didn't want to recompute it. I wanted it to be told to me. So we converted the algorithms from complicated to as simple as we could make them. And if we thought of a way to make them simpler, we did that. We passed all the necessary data. And the embedded system, where it had been kind of this playground of, gee, I think I can compute this. And how about if we handle the accelerations in this way? That went out of the embedded system and became part of the C++ or the C# stuff up in the Windows computer. I really like C++, but I also I'm not a big fan of stylish code. And there is a lot of fashion in the development world. And it's worth thinking about. Sometimes doing things in an old-fashioned way can get you where you need to be without, maybe it's not glamorous, but it's fast, because it's been working for a long time. So we replaced the strings with pod structs. So the one major advantage of that is that we had no unpacking to do. When the data arrived, it was intact. I was able to leave it in place. We did no copies once it arrived in the embedded side. I didn't need to look through it to see you know, where's this fourth piece? It was all laid out in front of me. Already the flaying had been done. In the process of changing from streaming to pod structs, because when I picked up the struct, there was an identifier at the top that said, this is your struct. You know, everything's laid out here. We didn't have to have encodings about, well, this other thing, this is an integer. We knew what it was. One identifier identified the entire struct, which is classic ancient C. This is so unfashionable. but it works. So not that it made any difference to the embedded side, other than, you know, the embedded side had no reformatting to do. But we also made sure that the data didn't get reformatted three other times along the way, which had been true. So we got the C-sharp code to build the right struct for us. And we just shoved that struct straight down top to bottom. And then we used a single enum to identify the entire structure. So that we could, basically we defined a set of structures that were all identically sized, which again is classic C. There was an enum up at the top, said, this is your struct, it fits in this window. And I could look at that enum and I could immediately dispatch to a command. And then there's this problem of, well, I want to have a pod struct, but all my Windows guys are writing in C-sharp. And C-sharp doesn't do pod structs. C-sharp wants to be in complete control of how stuff is laid out. So we couldn't do it in C. Well, we hacked. This was something that developed over time. We hacked C-sharp to do something kind of like what we needed. And then we made another run at it. We did something with C++, CLI, and macros. So what we were able to do was define or identify a subset of C++ and C++ CLI where we could use the same definition in both environments. So I could have one header file, one of which compiled for C++ CLI, one of which compiled in the embedded environment. And the identical structure would pop out of the end from that header file. Using C++ CLI in safe mode, which that was relevant to us because if it's safe, then if there's a chatty interface between C-sharp and C++ CLI, if it's safe, then that happens very quickly. So these are the macros that we used for that subset in the header files. My first thought at this was that I just wanted to, if you look at, this is really hard to read, but actually I don't need the laser pointer, I can just point. So this one is mixed use ref struct for C++, and it just calls itself a struct. This one is mixed use ref struct for C++ CLI in safe mode, and it says ref struct. My original thought was just to use ref, and we could have a macro for ref that would be present in C++ CLI and would just evaporate for C++. Turns out you can't do that because C++ CLI has this idea of keywords with whitespace. And ref struct is a keyword with whitespace. And if you separate those with a macro, it won't recognize that the whitespace is there. So you have to define it this way. But you can do it. You can do it. So using the macros to build these structures, we didn't do a lot of these. So this was just how a command was defined for the control computer. So it would fill in this struct, and then it would shoot it down. So only the commands needed to be written in this subset of the language. Here's a mixed-use value struct, which to us is just a struct. So the mixed-use enum, that's like struct, I can't remember. Anyway, so you can declare an enum, and C++ CLI in safe mode doesn't like const. So this was a const that would evaporate if it was for C++ CLI. So anyway, I included that because I imagine that someone else might wish to do intercommunication between safe mode C++ CLI and standard C++. And I thought I would let somebody know that there is a way to do it if you hold your tongue just right.
It looks very familiar. I consume a library written by other people who work who does exactly that.
Okay.
It looks really weird the first time you see it. Well, this illustrates something I've spent a lot of the last year fixing performance problems we introduced for supposedly cleaner architecture. And you wind up going way further up and down the stack than you think you would have to.
Yeah. So actually, I've been remiss. So Dave, this is for you. So part of getting these commands to run fast is getting fast loops. So at this point, I'm going to talk about my optimizer. So I have a compiler. There's an optimizer that runs with that compiler. And there were things that worked for me with my optimizer. And some of them may work for you. So the stuff I'm going to say about for loops is not universal. But it worked really well for me. I learned a lot while I was doing this. So DSP0 ended up being, so we have these acousto-optic deflectors. And we had computations to do for them. And DSP1 was already saturated, rising the galvos. So we ended up building the data for the acousto-optic deflectors as 1 microsecond points back over on DSP0. We would then hand that data, DMA that data over to DSP1. And we'll talk about DMAs later, I think, depending on time. Hand that data over to DSP1, and then DSP1 would shove that data into the hardware. But we were doing this work on DSP0. So we had 50 points. We have a 50 microsecond interrupt. We have to produce 50 points inside of that 50 microseconds in order to have 1 point per microsecond. So that means each point has to take a lot less than 600 microseconds because I've got to drive other things too. I've got to drive stages. I've got other work to do. So I needed fast loops. I really cared about my loop times. So one of the things that I've sort of historically done, and the Tiger Shark compiler manual encouraged me to do this yet more, I tend to look at disassembly from my C++. And if you're concerned about speed, I encourage you to do the same. This is the way to get to know your optimizer. So I don't know what to add to that, except I want to not go backwards. Okay, so the Tiger Shark disassembler does this amazing thing. I have no idea whether anyone else is compiler will do this. But it leaves notes in about how it optimized a particular loop. So every for loop,
That's pretty cool.
And I bet there aren't any compiler vendors in the room. But if there are, I love this. Do this. There is always some kind of a thought process going on behind how you're optimizing this loop. Let the people who are using your compiler know. This is just amazing because I can change a loop. I can go in and I can look at this header on the loop. Sometimes I'll want to go in and look at the details about how things were laid out in the loop and actually look at the instructions. But usually I could say, all right, I'm going to try this experiment to see if I can make this loop run faster. I do that, compile it, look at the disassembly, and it would say, oh, well, your loop now takes 48 cycles, or your loop is no longer a hardware loop, or whatever else. And this was a lifesaver. Probably for the tiger shark. The tiger shark has two, the processing unit has hardware loop counters that are useful because when the loop counter is running, it can identify when it's approaching the bottom of the loop. It will say, oh, I know, I'm going to continue doing this loop. And it completely avoids having a bubble in the execution line. And a bubble in the execution line costs 10 clocks. Let me back up. Does a bubble in the execution line sound like utter jargon to anybody in this room?
Yes.
Sounds like a pipeline stall.
Okay, let me back up. Beg pardon?
Pipeline stall?
Yeah. Yeah. So when processors are executing code, they like to execute code in a straight line. So they've got all these prefetch things running. Pick up a piece of information, and they've got a pipeline. So they pick up a piece of information, they do some kind of processing, and then they do some more processing. The Tiger Shark has a 10-stage pipeline. And it has some hardware so that when you've got branches and so forth, they try to manage what happens when you break the expectations in that pipeline. So every time you branch, the pipeline is really optimized for executing in a straight line. So every time you branch, the pipeline has to do something tricky. Now, it can be really clever tricky and not cost you any time. It can be somewhat clever tricky and save you some compute cycles. Or it could be, I'm sorry, you just went someplace I did not expect you to go. I got to fill the pipeline again. So you're losing clock cycles. You have the potential for losing clock cycles every time you branch. So here we are at the bottom. Think about a for loop. Okay, so you've got a choice. You can either unroll the loop, in which case it's all straight line code, or you can actually execute the loop, in which case when you hit the bottom of the loop, you have this this bubble that shows up in your pipeline, where you're losing stuff in your pipeline. You have to refill it and recompute stuff and start over again at the top. So the hardware loop counters help because the hardware says, oh, look, we're going to execute this loop counter instruction. I know where I'm going. I'm going back to the top. So a hardware loop counter saves me approximately 5 to 10 clock cycles for every loop execution. That's huge. For me, running on, actually for either of these problems, whether it's an ESP0 or ESP1, that makes a big difference. So I encourage hardware loop counters by pulling the const loop count out at the beginning. As soon as the compiler sees that, it says, oh, look at that. He knows how many times he's going to go through this loop. I may not know the exact number of times, but the loop counter can pick up a value, which is either going to be 3 or 7 or 9 or 50, and then it can execute that many times and not have the bubble at the bottom. That's as opposed to checking a condition, your typical while not null at the end of a string. Although I'm showing my age. Yes?
It's also important that it's a local variable and not like a member variable on an object. You want it to be local.
Thank you. You could come up here and do the next slide. that's very important. So are servers okay for you?
Okay, that's
right. Pass this back. The compiler, when I saw this, this was completely counterintuitive to me. I could not believe they were telling me to do this. But at least for my particular compiler, it was correct. So this is the idea of cascading small loops instead of doing one monster loop. And what I learned from looking at the disassembler is that if you have a small loop, it can use the registers better. So registers make sense to everybody? Everybody's been through some level of assembly language and knowing how computers work. So the thing about a monster loop is it's got a bazillion variables inside. And it doesn't know, well, which one of these am I going to keep around? So if you can make them small loops and cascade them, particularly if you know how many times you're going to execute the loop, so you can take advantage of the loop counter, then the cost for circulating around each of those for loops is zero. And it can localize more of the information into registers. Yes?
Is there a trade-off against locality of reference? I mean, if you're looping over things in memory, for example, you probably only want to traverse those once, right?
Yeah, and I think that's more of an issue for people who do big computing. So for me personally, in my environment, I didn't tend to have big data structures that I needed to walk through. And all of my memory was inside the chip. So I didn't have a huge cost of, gee, we have to fetch this off the main memory into the cache. But for people who are doing bigger computing than I do. Then I think you have an excellent point. Yes.
The benefit of this cascading small loops is that you get better cache utilization with the instruction cache. Because if you're lucky, the entire loop buddy will be in the instruction cache and you won't have to look it up.
Yeah.
You said the loops are going to be free then? You don't have to pay for the increment of the counter? As it turns out, or is it just so cheap that you don't?
So at that point, it's so cheap, I don't worry about it. With the static superscalar, it's interesting to watch the disassembly take place. That generally, like register operations, will end up happening two or three of them inside of the same clock cycle. So the thing that I really ended up sweating about with the loops was lost time. Do I have a clock cycle that's going to go by where nothing useful happens? I wanted something useful to happen. And if I could, I wanted three or four useful things to happen inside of one clock cycle. Yes?
So the problem is, of course, if you make them too small. And I mean, optimizers do have loop fusion passes which actually turn the left-hand side into the right-hand side. So apparently it doesn't apply to all architectures. Or I mean, they probably have heuristics to not use loops that are already under register pressure.
Yeah, with all of this stuff, what you're doing is you're going back to the disassembler, looking at what your compiler did for you.
Oh, damn.
It's 10:30. Anyone who wants to go should feel free to go. I'll continue talking for as long as people want to hang around. And then, when's the next set of sessions?
There's a half an hour break right now.
There's a half an hour break?
Yeah.
So, yeah, I'm way behind schedule. But yeah, people should feel free to go. And before folks leave, if there's anyone that I owe skills to, come get some skills. So, don't make function calls inside of loops, because that's also a nonlinear flow. The other thing that happens is that you lose, the compiler loses context. So if you do have stuff that's in member variables, when it comes back, it doesn't know whether those are modified or not. So it will pick those up again. And we're just about to get to your point. Let's go ahead and get to that. We'll come back. There we go. Copy number two. Yes?
The null function calls inside groups, isn't it fine if it's an inline function?
Yes. So it's an actual literal function call.
Okay.
Yeah, so if there's a call assembly instruction,
right,
then that's probably a bad thing. Inlining is amazing. No problem with inlining. So to get to your point about copy numbers to locals, the thing about local variables is that the compiler will keep those in registers. Anything that has a place in memory, it may be inclined to leave it in memory. But locals, it will think of in terms of registers. Or at least for me, that's what it did. So what I tended to do was I would, constant locals of members that will be constant inside the loop. So I would pull up those members. They might not be const as members. But if I know that they're not going to change during the loop, I'll pull those up and declare them const. It is, by the way, completely counterintuitive. You're writing more code. It looks like more lines of code. Don't let it fool you. It just looks like more lines of code. The compiler has to do this work anyway. At least for the Tiger Shark, it has to have that stuff in a register in order to operate. It doesn't know how to operate directly on memory. So go ahead and bring that stuff up. Write the extra lines of code. Bring that stuff up. Make it local. Make it const. And now the compiler says, not only am I going to have this thing in the register, but I don't have to worry about that value change. It tells the compiler a lot. I bring in non-const variables and make those locals, but you can't make them const, because we're going to be changing them during the loop. And then when I fall out of the loop, I do have to remember to pick up those values and shove them back into the member variables. But this is really important. Let me back up a couple of slides. So we've got the no function call. So what I end up using with for loops is this pound pragma no alias, which is a Tiger Shark specific spelling of this. The C version of this is
restrict.
Yes. So you can do this by declaring certain variables restrict. This was just the habit that I got into. Is not necessarily better. But in general, a compiler has to assume, in order to do its job correctly, the compiler must assume, if it gets two pointers, that the data from those pointers will overlap. And that really restricts the way in which it can reorder accesses. So with this no alias, I can tell the compiler, that's me making a promise to the compiler, I'm a good boy, I don't have anything overlapping between these pointers. You don't have to worry about it, reschedule any way you want. That becomes my responsibility. So if the data gets corrupt, that's my problem. But it lets the optimizer do a much better job.
It's really critical for vectorization on the encoded chips.
Okay.
You have to do this, otherwise, like you said, it just becomes.
Yeah. Dennis Ritchie did not like no alias. Now, I think he mostly didn't like it in terms of libraries. And if I were writing library functions, I would be scared stiff, because I would be saying to anyone who used this function, gee, I don't have any way of enforcing this, but you'd better not have any overlap between the pointers. And so I sympathize with this perspective, but I use it anyway, because it makes a huge difference on the variables that I get at. Do use intrinsics, particularly inside of loops, because every cycle counts. How many of you know what an intrinsic is? Yeah, okay, most of you. So an intrinsic is a special function, if you will, that the compiler provides. And it looks just like a function. But the compiler recognizes this and says, oh, I know how to turn that function into a single assembly instruction, or some small set of assembly instructions. And the optimizer goes to town with these. The Tiger Shark had floating point min, max, copy sign, some other functions. And the min and max intrinsics made a big difference for me. So use these. Now, if you have multiple targets, So for me, I was using these intrinsics, and I had Windows stuff and Tiger Shark stuff that I wanted to compile with the same compiler. So the way I approached that was I would, so here are the Tiger Shark intrinsics that I wanted to, or a couple of them that I wanted to support. Some of them just came with a compiler. If you said fminf, the Tiger Shark compiler automatically recognized that and says, oh, I know what to do with this. And says, thank you. But with the Windows compiler, you had to tell it fminf, well, do this. And so this allowed me to use the intrinsics naturally in two different compilers.
And yes. This Windows compiler actually has some sort of built-ins for min and max.
Yeah, it does have some. I used fminf and the compiler said, I don't know what that is, so I put these out. Have you had any skills yet?
I don't think so.
You don't? Oh, so. Throwing food. So, at the end of this, I was doing my research with a particular loop because I'd written this loop and it's like, oh my god, I'm not going to make my timing. So I started with that loop, and when I coded it originally, I did not have the constant loop size at the top. So I was checking for completion at the top of the loop. So I changed that, and immediately the compiler told me that I had gone from a non-hardware loop to a hardware loop. So I knew that was a good thing. That was saving me some number of cycles at the end of the loop. That gave me, that particular hardware loop ended up having 52 cycles per iteration. And then by the time I'd done everything else, and it took some days, you know, going through the compiler manual and so forth, ended up with a hardware loop with 18 cycles per iteration. I'm going to do one more point. Yeah, I'm running behind. So one thing that's particularly relevant for C++ is it has templates. C doesn't have templates. And so this is a really cool template, what I think is a cool template technique. And basically it allows you to tell the compiler everything you can think about. So a compiler can't see the value of a member variable, even if that member variable is const. It can't see the value of it at compile time. But you can do that with a template. So when you can turn something like that, laser pointer doesn't do any good at all. Or I've got a constant chan. I know what chan's going to do. I know what that's going to be at compile time. Make that not a member variable. Make it a template parameter. So we'll talk about this in a minute. There's code bloat that comes with this. You have to treat it carefully. You always treat templates with respect. But if you turn this into a template parameter, the compiler can now see it. With this, and I'm jumping ahead, but with this particular technique, I was able to get rid of, I had a function call on my servo era dealing with DMAs. I was able to get rid of the function call that had a switch inside of it because the compiler knew what value the switch was going to have. We got rid of the function call, I got rid of the switch, and ended up turning it into about 40 nanoseconds worth of inline code by doing this.
Can you do the same by making it non-literal? Wouldn't it be simpler?
No, because, well, it has to be a template parameter because the value that it has to be visible at compile time.
Right.
So the thing is, if it's a member variable, it doesn't know what that value is.
Right. It'd be the enum literal.
That would work.
It would be.
So I think the issue is it has to be a parameter either to like a constructor or as a template parameter, and by making it a template parameter, now it's knowing compile time versus at runtime. Right?
Yes. So the point is to do this at compile time, not at runtime.
So if you have a variable, it's not just a variable that has a fixed value, it's a variable that you pass into the constructor.
Yeah, you could do that.
Or have some other way of setting it.
Yeah, what I will say is that for my particular compiler, I think if I passed that value in at construction time, there was enough distance between the constructor and where it got used that the compiler might not have kept track of that fact, that it knew that value at construction time. With the template, there's just no question that if channel is 2, the 2 is in the face of the compiler every time that object comes into play. So it knows it for the entire operation of the compilation. So I believe this is probably more reliable in terms of telling your compiler what's up.
So then for every instantiation, basically you prune out all the other parts of the switch statement.
Yeah. Precisely. Precisely. So you do want to factor parameter independent code out of templates because you don't want to code them. And so the way at least the way I did that was by, and this is not rocket science, this is good C++ practice. I built a class that was my implementation, and that's where all the code went. And then the template that actually knew that it was channel 2 just had inlines that forwarded to here. And then my implementation could choose whether it wanted something inlined or not. And I am 15 minutes over time. I'm not at the end of my slides, but I think I should probably let y'all go. Thanks very much for